Is it weird to be trending as lesbians are hot right now? Is
that trending? Oh Lord. It's better that we're trending that way than not. I hope that it continues to trend, people don't forget, and that the movie gains a sort of social traction that pushes a conversation, ultimately, about how it is we behave and how we inhabit the world and how, you know, we don't always have to talk about who we are in quite the ways that we're expected to. And my favorite thing I've read about this whole tweeting, trending thing is someone said something like, I want the U.S. Supreme Court to see Carol right now. You know?
Yeah.
And I thought, yeah, actually, you know, let's get Scalia to take a look at it. I wonder what he'd think.
He's still busy trying to, you know, get around the Blue is the Warmest Color without getting caught by Netflix.
God, you're bad.
They know when he's sleeping. They know when he's awake.
Yeah.
So, I mean, is that the ultimate good? The ultimate goal is for it not to be a conversation and just to be.
Well, I mean, ultimately, that's going to take a long time. But if this adds to a conversation already in progress, a number of conversations already in progress about women-driven films, and can they be successful if they're not comedies? You know, it's like we're okay with comedies, but when we make fools of ourselves. But as yet, is there a serious money-making, to whatever extent that has significance for an independent film?
Right.
I mean, we're not going to make, you know, $300 million. It would be great, but money is power. You know, we know that. If this film can get one other film that is female driven in most aspects, then that will be what I would consider to be the best thing that could happen. It's a serious thing. It appeals to a wide variety of people, and yes, women can carry this, but we all have to, we being women who have any measure of success, using that to help other women get there. I think that's very important and easily overlooked in all of this. So I hope that does some good in that way, too.
So was that a priority for you on this journey as you... Because you were the first person to really be involved with this.
Yes. Not really. I mean, you know, you can't... I wasn't thinking about all that. Now, when it's made and we can sort of see that other people are liking it, you can have a hope. You can have the optimism that... All right, if this is going to enter some serious discussion of what's good, if we're going to be held up in any way, however small or large, then yeah, let's have this conversation.
But is it important to have, like, Christine on it as a woman and as a gay person? Is that
sure,
a priority?
Sure, a lot of us are. No, I don't think I don't think anyone thought in those terms of putting any of us together because we fit a certain... we had a certain bill to fill, but as it happens, most of the driving forces behind this have been women, starting with Tessa Ross, who has been the big proponent of this. She's kept it alive the whole time, in one way or another, Liz Carlson, who is an old friend of Christine's. We've all worked together before. There are a lot of gay people on this film, which is extraordinary. You know, you think gay producers, gay writer, gay director, gay... I don't know who else, but, you know, there are some.
Yeah.
And they can tell you themselves. And we have, you know, it's not a tiny little movie. We wanted it to be able to exist... outside of a certain parameter of film, indie film, and it looks like, you know, we'll be allowed to do that.
It's interesting because I've gotten into a fight about this in the last couple of days, in particular on my blog. Well, I wrote a piece about this conversation now going on about women in film and the situation, and I'm kind of it was in anticipation of the Pitch Perfect opening, and that, you know, firstly that it was important to remember that Elizabeth Banks was a producer on both movies, and that she's driving that train regardless of whether she was director on the second movie or not.
Sure.
But also that there's there is a ghetto. But that the ghetto can be extremely profitable and it's where a lot of films live, and there's nothing really wrong with that. I don't think women have to start making action movies in order to be satisfied with their position in the film business. Obviously, there need to be more women directors working and employed by studios and all that, but there's a kind of like there's an archness to it right now that feels like it's somehow none of that's enough. It has to be the whole bite for people to be happy.
Yeah, I'm not sure what that even means. I'm not sure what it means. I think it's probably born of a general frustration that's invading all groups of people right now, in the U.S. in particular. Mm-hmm. I have no desire to have every piece of the pie because, geez, I couldn't possibly do that. And I wouldn't be good as an action writer or a director. But there are women, of course, who have done that. Catherine Bigelow and various others who have actually, yes, the progress in those areas is slow. But I don't know what the numbers are, you know, the proportion of women who actually want to do that. What's important to me is for the... you know, there is an assumption, and I've been through this in meetings with people, there is an assumption always that if you're a woman, you're interested in telling female stories.
Mm-hmm.
And by that I don't mean your leads are female. What I mean is you are obsessed with motherhood, babies, getting your man, etc., etc. And really, I am not interested in that at all. That's the last thing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, someone recently said to me, well, I have something about kids. Are you interested in kids? And I said, well, only if they kill in the movie or, you know, they're killed. Not to be glib,
right.
But, you know, I'm interested in gambling, sports, mobsters, etc. And I think we will have made significant progress when the assumption isn't immediate. That you know, there are always people who are interested in stories of women in, I guess, what are considered more or less traditional roles.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of those people are men. You know, I think, well, look, why don't you offer that to Almodovar? Because he does that in a beautiful, unexpected way. But it doesn't have to be that women are relegated to one thing, men are relegated to another.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't think we'll improve or the situation will improve sufficiently for some people until that's not part of the conversation, until subject matter. It's the subject matter that has to be gender neutral.
Mm-hmm.
It's not that we get to do action movies or we get to do... It's when you sit down and someone expresses surprise that you're interested in mobsters. Really? I didn't know that. It's like, yeah, sports, love baseball. Yeah. I'd love to do a baseball movie. I know a lot about it. And slowly, as more writers and more directors are more bold about saying, look, really, I have an interest in these other things. I'm not really good at that.
Well, it's funny because you share with Mangella the Highsmith thing, and yet you probably are more interested in more... aggressive material in general than he was when he was working.
Yeah,
so.
That's probably true. Yes, I know that's true. But, you know, Carol, I think, has lots of the usual Highsmithian elements that are lurking underneath this very tense, odd, gem-like love story. And those are always the best love stories anyway.
So what was the first inkling of starting this for you?
Well, it was when I was approached. A producer held the rights to the book. And she came looking for a writer. My agent in the UK said, oh, I think she'd be great at it. And that's how it happened. We got Film 4 to finance the development.
Mm-hmm.
It was the very first script that I was paid to write. So the first draft of that, 15-ish years ago, the whole experience has been like an instant primer in what happens to movies and how movies get made and how they don't get made and what you can expect and the highs and the lows and the ridiculousness along the way and what people ask you to do. And, you know, it was a huge learning experience. Mm. And what I learned most of all is the power of saying, no, that won't work. Mm. Or, well, after a time, I was the one who was the repository of all information about the book. So someone could say, well, why don't you, can we try this? And I'd say, I tried that in 2005, it doesn't work. And by the time we got to Todd, you know, that was the right thing. Mm. So 15 years ago, that wouldn't have happened.
So how different a screenplay was it from the time you started, to the time you shot?
Well, you know how that happens with the various revolving door of people coming, going, different attachments, this, that. Never actors.
So sometimes those drafts in the middle just kind of disappear and you go back to the...
That's exactly what happened. As we moved along, and then there were some years when I just said, listen, I want to put this back to what it was now that we don't have to please X. Mm-hmm. And gradually, it came closer and closer and closer to that first that first attempt with some, you know, some key changes, and I grew up along the way, and that was helpful. And then when Todd came on board, we had this very good period of about a month or two where we would have discussions, phone, email. I mean, we live in different cities. And, and we would talk about what it's all about, tuning or shifting the kaleidoscope this way or that. And we talked about, you know, things that really interested him, not only about the novel or the script, but cinematic references, things like that. And so I did, you know, we would talk, I'd go away and do a thing, or a draft, well, not really a draft. At this point, they were more like polishes, getting it right. And then we did another one, and that was that.
So were you, I mean, when you did this as your first movie script, as your first, you know, as the experience that you're talking about, were you, like, deeply committed to the idea that this would someday get made, or was it something that you kind of had to give up on as you went along and did other projects?
Well, at first, I thought, oh, this is marvelous, and then about halfway through, I thought, oh, this is never going to get made, and I don't want to even see it again, and go away. And I, of course, moved on to other things and wrote other scripts and, you know, just made a career. And there was a point, I have to say, when the rights in the book lapsed, whenever that was, 2010, I thought, that's it. I love this, but, you know, forget about it. Mm-hmm. You know, it's just going to live in your drawer, and one day you'll act it out with some friends, and that'll be it. And then Liz Carlson, with whom I had worked before, bought the rights to the novel. She convinced the estate to give them to her. And then she called me up and said, guess who has the rights to the book? And even at that point, I said, oh, I don't know, Liz. It's just, I've been so disappointed. And, you know, this is a long thing. I'm tired. I've grown old. I've been, you know, let me go. And she said, no, we're going to make another movie. It's going to be great. And so I said yes, and because the script was in turnaround, and basically I controlled the destiny of it. Mm. And I could have said, we came that close all along the way. I came that close to saying, you know what, I'm sure you could find someone to do a, you know, bang up job. But she and Tessa Ross wouldn't take no for an answer.
So cinema has changed a lot in the 15 years you've been waiting for this to happen.
Wow.
I mean, is the context for Carol for you any different, or is it its own piece and that doesn't matter?
Well, partially it's its own piece, especially in the finished film. But things never change. You know, we're having, you know, we have the same discussions, we have the same problems, not as much, Mm-hmm. But it's always tricky putting together the money for things like this. Whether it was just, it's not even the gay thing. Then it becomes, well, this is an adult movie that's deliberate, of a certain style, of a certain pace, and the script itself is elliptical and just subtext and full of, not full of conversations that tell anyone what they should think. Mm-hmm. So, of course, that's always hard. You know, much easier it would have been if we had sat down and done a draft with tons of voiceover and explanatory, expositional, you know, is Abby in love with her? This would have been great. And we probably, it would have been easier. We would have had it made 8 years ago, and it would have sunk without a trace. Whoever would have made it, you know.
Well, it's amazing that Harvey hasn't insisted on that already.
You know what?
It's so much his habit, but I guess he likes the movie.
No, as far as I know, he's been absolutely great in touch it.
Yeah.
Honestly, but you would have to ask Todd. But in our discussions, I've been told no.
He was just infamous for his voiceover auditions.
Oh, no. Well, see, we did that good a job that there was no temptation. Yeah. To use the voiceover.
Well, one of the things that's striking is you know, Todd doing Far From Heaven. You know, it's a much more melodramatic, highly stylized piece.
A different thing. But I think we both, I mean, this is the first time he's directed something he hasn't written, and I think he had a great time, I had a great time. Well, yeah, I can't speak for him, because we've had this discussion. It was a good, fruitful collaboration that sparked things in both of us, because we are, I mean, I don't know if we're similar people, but we certainly... Mm-hmm. have a similar interest in the same thing cinematically, and certainly on a level of writing. He understood instantly that it lives where it needs to live, and that no amount of softening the men or doing this or that, you know, it's not that. They are actually understandable. And what I love about it is that your attitude toward any one of them shifts from scene to scene. In some scenes, you think LaHarge is a creep. Mm. But then, no, I quite understand. And that's, I think, the thing that everyone carried with them throughout this. It's like, you know, yeah, he has a point. She has a point. He has a point. And then we just behave as we behave and take the consequences.
Mm.
So,
well, they're surprisingly adult characters in terms of their behavior. They're not.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, they are, and they're acted by real adults. So, everyone was on the same page, which you can't often say.
So, did you have a whole generation of actresses in your head from year to year who might be playing these roles, or?
No, actually, because, well, when I was writing it, I don't like to do that, because I think it's limiting. If anything, I had an image in my mind of Grace Kelly from Rear Window, specifically from Rear Window. That tension between the absolutely pristine beauty, unruffled, and the absolutely filthy woman lurking underneath that surface. So that's what informed the writing of the character of Carol for me. Which was helpful, because I had to invent her, really, in many ways, because the book is so much Therese's fever dream of Carol. And I wanted to say thanks, Pat, you know. But yes, thanks, Pat, for allowing that freedom.
So that became your point of reference for her?
Well, for my personal point of reference for Carol when initially writing it and carrying it through. That I just imagined that person. What would she do? What would she say to come on to this girl? You know, and I think it's actually pretty close to what that character in that movie, as played by Grace Kelly, would have done.
And Therese.
Well, I knew Pat, and so Therese is very much an alter ego of Pat in the novel. She's really like a sieve. She's a sponge. She soaks everything in, has very little personality, of her own except as a watcher, as a lurker, as a stalker, if you will, which was Pat. And so I imagine the young Pat, and of course I had pictures of her, and I knew her, and I knew the way she spoke and the way she thought. It was this, almost this otherworldly, flung out of space thing, which Rooney Mara just nails. She just inhabits it.
Well, it's a very tough, that's in some ways a tougher performance, in that it's so, you know, there is so little to hang on to, and it's like a little bit too much, and it would be wrong.
Right.
There's something very dry about it, and yet she has to be passionate.
Yeah. Who knows how she does that? But, you know, she had some help from Kate, she had some help from Todd, she had some help from the script, so however that alchemizes, it was perfect.
So were you on set?
Yeah, I was. I wasn't there the whole time. I chose to be there for all the scenes that were shot among the principals. So the quartet, Rooney, Kate, Kyle, and Sarah Paulson.
Mm-hmm.
So I was there for a while, and we worked. I mean, you know, things come up. You lose a location. It was all shot on location. So how could we make this work in the hotel room as opposed to the bathroom or whatever it was? And I was, you know, we had a number of those situations, and what was great is that Todd was so... he was more protective of the scripts than I was. Excuse me, but I didn't have to be protective of it because I knew that it was in extremely good hands, and I knew how to change it, how it could work. Probably because I'd spent so many wasted my youth on trying to see this through. So it came in handy actually all those years. Because let's do this. It's fine. But he was great.
So were there any surprises in ultimately what he shot when you saw the picture come together?
What he shot? No. We shot, I mean, Todd mentioned this, I think, at the press conference. We shot more material than we used in the film. And when I saw the early cuts, I thought, there was a single moment where I thought, you know, where did that go? But mostly it was out of admiration for the work the actors were doing in those scenes. It wasn't, well, that's not my favorite scene, or it's my favorite scene. Or it was more about that and wanting everyone to have everything they did as a record. But, yeah, I mean, there were a couple of guys, I had some questions. And I go, if you do this, then what will happen there?
Right.
And so all of us, the producers and Todd, we all talked about it. And we were all very happy with whatever. I mean, there were some things that were cut that were like whole characters from the department store. And it just works. I mean, you can't argue with something that works. It's churlish. So you may be fond of something. But look, it's their job, he and Fonzie, to... make this damn movie. It's not my job.
So when you see it, when it's coming out, we're having a premiere as we did here in Cannes, how do you feel about that experience? Are you experiencing it as the writer? Or are you just enjoying the movie and love?
At this point, I'm just watching the movie because I've seen it a number of times, but never under perfect circumstances. So Todd and I saw it on a sound stage, so we heard it was sounded fabulous, but print was off, that kind of thing. There was always something off. And last night was the first time I've seen it. It's perfect with the quality that Ed was going after, and the film and the color and the. It was fantastic to see it, and I probably won't ever see it again like that, right?
Do you want? Will you want to? Will you want to not see it again? Do you? I mean, what's the?
Well, I always have a very strange relationship to my own work. I don't like to be at opening nights. Coming from the theater, it's bad luck. You know, I just like to sit in the back and have a drink and a cigarette and and wait for people to come out and say, this is the worst thing I've ever seen, you know, or, yeah, or the best thing I've ever seen. We'll take that too. But I don't know if I can, I don't know. It'll be, now I won't see it for some time, mm-hmm. but I got, you know, last night it was, I was not antsy, but I was aware that I was in an audience full of people who were invited, who were dressed up and probably uncomfortable in their suits.
Mm-hmm.
So I kept hearing everything. I kept hearing the coughing and the shuffling, and I thought, wow, okay, so the people hate it. And then apparently not.
Yeah.
So it's best for, I, you know, it's nerve-wracking.
And how is that red carpet for you? Do you?
Holy moly. Well, yeah, making that exit was the most surreal thing I think I've ever been through in my life, because I said to Kate, it's like being in the Miss America pageant or a prom, mm-hmm. as we genteelly advance down these stairs, but you can't because there's all of these fucking light bulbs going off and you're suddenly blind and you don't know where you're stepping. So we were all just, you know, look like here we are all being a team, but really we're holding on to each other for dear life.
Trying not to break your neck.
Exactly. So, but that was, I had a real insight into the life of a movie star. You think, wow, that you don't go blind, first of all, by the time you're 30 is a major achievement, but this unreality that really sets in, people screaming, not screaming for me, and not even screaming for Todd, but screaming for, you know, wow, I admire them even more for doing that.
It's a fascinating skill set. And then Kate having to graciously somehow dance around the story about her, which was blown up and made a worldwide sensation until she said it never really happened.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. Well, apparently, you know, he left out part of her answer, which was the $1 million part of the answer. Right?
Yeah.
But never mind. I mean, she's right. Who cares? Why do we care that she may or may not have? I mean, I would care if I were her partner, but otherwise,
Well, I think it's just that it's the falseness of it. It's an interesting festival because there's also the Amy Winehouse documentary, which is...
Right, I'd love to see that.
Very tough on, as a media person, because you realize you're a participant in the death of somebody. And,
really.
And the little deaths that other, you know, that people who are very gracious, I mean, Kate's always very gracious, but... you know, suffer through this process all the time.
It's part of the pact, isn't it?
Yeah.
You take the good and the horrendous, and if you can't go, it's really what it means. You develop not so much a thick skin, but the older you get, or maybe the more mature you get, you realize, look, people are entitled not to like your work. They are entitled to not like it as much as sometimes they might like it.
Mm.
And everyone has their day in the gutter. So just don't... It's not that you don't take it personally. If you know that you've done good work, things are swinging roundabouts. Eventually, someone will rediscover it. But I don't think it's something you initially learn, you know. You have to have some sort of disappointment to acquire the grace to just say, hey, look, these are just movies. You know, it's not life or death. You will go on to make something else, and one day somebody will come up to you when you least expect it and say, I loved that. Isn't that why that's why you do it. It's to understand that, you know, not everyone has to. In fact, it's preferable.
Nope.
You know, if it's preferable that you have some dissent in the ranks.
Yeah.
Because if you're like me, when I read the reviews, especially for theater, for plays, and they're all unanimously raves, I will not go see it. I know that means it's mediocre. I know it. You know, similarly with all bad reviews.
Right.
But when there's a real divergence of opinion, that's when I know we have something interesting.
Yeah.
And very rarely, when the reviews are all raves of a certain kind for certain kinds of movies, it's like the stars align and it's the perfect time for it, which I hope is the case with us. I hope. worth seeing. But it's good to have somebody saying, you know, you suck every once in a while to remind you that, you know, everyone is sucks every once in a while.
Well, I don't think you're going to get it sucks in this movie, but I do think it's going to be an interesting journey. Because it's a long, I mean, it's a long road. The trajectory of the film is to Academy Award season at this point. And, you know, 6 months, 7 months doing that, it's a long road. And a lot of, you know, highs and lows along the way.
A lot of highs and lows. I mean, I have no idea what the general plan is.
Yeah.
I mean, I know that they've now pretty much settled on a release date, but I have no idea if they're going to go to North American festivals, if it's worth it. I think
I would guess New York Film Festival.
That would be nice.
Either opening or closing.
Yeah, that would be
That'd
great.
Be my bet.
New
and then
York would be nice.
Opening 2 weeks later.
Yeah.
And limited.
Yeah.
And it's very slow rollout. Mm-hmm. Go wide in December.
You know, I mean, it's great because the way I will look at this all, of course, you have to participate. You have to go along for the ride. But I would see it as a real good excuse to get more nice clothes made. You know, it's just, you know.
So you're going to enjoy it no matter what happens.
Everyone loves a party, yes. And to not focus on that whole schemey awards prospect of it, just to be in the moment and do what's required of you and not act like a baby and just.
But you don't seem terribly caught up in the politics, I guess, of it or the idea of it. I mean, I think it sounds like for you the work speaks for itself and. You've done your job and you don't have to campaign for...
No, I mean, it's part of the job if that is what's happening.
Well, I mean campaign politically more than for the award season.
I'm not even sure I would know how to do that. I'm not the most politic person, but I am always happy to talk to people and be engaged and nice. Mm-hmm. And I think if that means I have to go around or if I'm asked to go around, of course... That's what you do to support the film.
Mm-hmm.
But it wouldn't be to support me personally, you know, just me personally. There's no, like, Lady Macbeth thing going on.
Right.
It's like, we must win. But I...
Well, there was certainly the frustration of Brokeback Mountain for people was, you know, had more... There were so many layers to it, I guess, when it happened.
Yeah.
And the question of whether there's homophobia within the Academy and how significant that is and all that kind of stuff.
I don't know. We can't know. No. Unless we go around and ask every person, hey, are you a homophobe? And then they're going to lie. So what's the point?
Not many people answer that question, honestly. Unless they're not.
Well, unless they're a little... But no, I wouldn't think you'd get honest answers. So all you can do is represent the film and just focus on that. And I think other things come along with it. What will happen will happen. People will either support the whole film or various elements of it, and none of that's bad. The ultimate goal is to have the film be successful, whatever that means, and have a lot of people see it and maybe change a mind or two along the way about the various things that are talked about in the film.
And I think it, you know, obviously it's very specific in as to the lesbian situation. However, I think it's also there's a universality to the whole choice to be not a person who speaks of everything, and all that is as universal regardless of your sexuality.
That's right, and the difference between living a private life, a public life, what it means to be a responsible parent, you know, for God's sake, that's. He actually touches a lot of bases without speechifying, or it just puts people in situations in which they must make choices, which, you know, that's always a great thing to be able to have. And of course, that comes from the book, partially, and partially when we've invented other things, but that fit in with the general themes of observation, things overlooking other things, spying. and so it's good to finally see that it's not just us who think it works. We can be very proud of it, but now it's out there. And there's a little sadness about that, because I loved being able to say to people, oh, it's really good. But then they hadn't seen it. You know? So it's just ours now, and it's not ours anymore. It's whoever wants to, you know, take it. It's your movie.
But that's got to be exciting, too.
Well, yeah, of course it is. It's great. And it's just going to... Nowadays, it's going to live. I mean, it's not going to disappear. Mm. And like so many times over the years when we all, whoever was with it, just worried about that. It was going to live for the rest of its life in my desk. Which, you know, it could have. So
yeah.
I'm glad it didn't.
Now just live on the screen somewhere. And then on your TV, and then on your phone. And
not on my phone. I don't want to watch that on my phone. I can't. I won't be able to see it, for one thing. Yeah.
Excellent. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you.
Appreciate it.
It's a pleasure.
A pleasure indeed.
Let me give you your thing back.